Mga kababayan ko, magandang gabi po sa inyong lahat. Nandito po kami para ipaalam sa inyo yung mga palisiya na dapat nating sundin at direksyon natin kung saan tayo patungon. Lahat na ito po ay ginagawa namin, believe me, because the interest of the nation calls for it, demands for it actually. I have to be productive as president. And in order to do that, I have to go around and look for myself the situation all throughout the country. That is the job of the president, seeing to it that the republic is well guarded and the welfare of the people is the highest concern. Itong klase po, nandito si Secretary Briones. She will tell us what is her policy and what are her plans for the studentry, mga estudyante. She's here to explain to you, and maybe isali ko na yung deadline ng tuition. Yung tuition ho sana, I hope that you'd allow a staggered payment or installments lang po sa mga eskwelahan. And for those who have really nothing to come up to sa bayaran, you have the land bank, and kindly listen to the rules, kasi itong land bank bubuksan namin, and you can borrow money to finance the education of your children. Lahat ito, papunta ito sa talagang negative, meaning to say that we are hard-pressed in our finances, but we have to place the premium of education, so that this would be another round of expenses, but Land Bank is there to help you. And dito po ako interesado. I want the development of this endeavor of the Land Bank to help. Gusto kong malaman na matutupad talaga. So maybe I will require a report every day of how it goes, how it would present itself to the public once it is available. And you know, the NCR will now be placed under the General Community Quarantine, or the JCQ, starting June 1. Davao City will remain GCO. But just let me tell you today that of those who are of late infection or those arriving in the country, we have a spike of about 5,000. Secretary, 500 rather, sorry, 500 lang. and Secretary Duque will expound more on that. The rest of the country will be placed under modified general community quarantine. Again, the rest of the country will be placed under modified general community quarantine. That is very clear now. In other areas, it will be again on a piecemeal basis, depending on the viability of the place to meet the challenges of COVID. But from time to time, Secretary Roque would give us the places where there will be changes. The opening of the airports. I have asked Secretary Tugadi, and he will have his time later, to explain what are his plans. We would like to know, sabay-sabay tayo. Then dito sa assistance ng OFW, we are coordinating with every government agency to help them. Sana po hindi na ito maulit. Yung there was this stranded Filipinos not knowing where to go and when. We decided immediately that they be returned to their home provinces. Nangyari po ito, halos sa kanila naka-uwi na. But we are expecting the 300,000 something that Secretary Bellew has communicated to us. And that would be also a problem again. But this time, we should know what to do. It's a matter of calibrating every arrival and maybe sending immediately, if possible, the overseas workers coming in first. Unless, of course, they are detained because of they are sick of COVID. I mean sick, talagang kailangan ng ospital. Dito naman sa, well, let me appeal to the itong mga landlords, the owner of lahat na malls, bazaars, big stores, whatever, na merong mga anong tawag nito, yung franchise nila sa may mga different stores selling different anything. What you have is the you own this the big building to be rented out. Marami dito sa kanila po gusto ninyo na magbayad ng 50% even if they are not operating. Actually, I am at a loss really to explain to you how. But you know, when you collect from somebody who is not earning at all, it's practically flogging a dead horse. Kung patay na yung kabayo, basi gaano mo kahampas dyan, di na mabubuhay yan. And that is what's happening. If they are not earning, where will they get the 50% to pay? If not the 100% that you'd want to collect. So, it seems to me a problem, but I would like to appeal to the owners of the buildings, of the malls and everything. Ganito na lang, just pray everybody has a God. just pray that the vaccine, ang target nila is September. September, I think China will be able to distribute, if I'm not mistaken, and the other countries are catching up. Everybody is at it, so they are really trying their very best. Kaya lang, itong China, hindi ito hambog, wala itong ere, but they you know, they work, and I'm very sure that they will be the first one of the countries that would be able to come up with the vaccine. Ang atin ito is yung mga rental sana, balikan ko, should be a matter that should be addressed by the DTI, and there can be some sort of an adjudication process to fix this problem. Ako naman, nagkikiusap, nagmakaawa, dahil nga talagang, if you're not earning, how are you supposed to pay? So, maawa naman tayo sa mga kababayan natin. Let us help one another. If it does not really spell bankruptcy sa inyo, eh di tiisin na lang ninyo with nothing except your savings to tide you over. Baka sakali makatulong yung appeal ng gobyerno. Remember that the nation is still, the entire nation is still under quarantine. Let us move to the so-called new normal as we, let's see what develops ahead. Okay, kung mayroon lang bukas, I will be the first to announce. But alam mo, remember, the COVID microbes are still in the air that you breathe, that you pass on to your fellow men if you are not ready or willing to wear the mask. It is precisely, this is the protection, not for you if you do not want it, but for the protection of the other guy. And that is why the state has every right to control your movement if you pass on a contagion to the other to the population. Kasi kung ikaw lang ang gusto, ayaw mo, and there are people who are like that, ayaw nila. And they believe that they have the antibodies to fight the coronavirus. So, the virus is there. Tapos gusto mong labanan, bahala ka. But for you to pass that virus, if you get it from one place and from another person and pass it to the other guy, that's different. That is where the right of the state comes in. So that to prevent a mass contagion, gusto namin putulin kung saan namin maputol to stop it. That is the reason of the essence of the police power of the state, to come up with measures to protect public interest, public health, public safety, lahat. Nandiyan na yan. Case of peace and order, magkagulo, the state comes in. Yung may contagion and everybody is dying, falling, kasali yan. Public interest, if say, uncontrolled movement, or baski ano, people trying to seize other people's property or things like just being into a state of anarchy. The state has the right to come in and put a stop on it. It is the survival of the Republic of the Philippines. Now, this is the country of Filipinos who obey the laws. If you do not obey the law, that's your problem. Bahala ka. Good kung makasibat ka. Kung hindi ka makasibat, ay, pasensya ka. And that goes for everybody. That should be made clear. Hindi kasi ano ng tao na they take for granted violating the law. Now, we start a program. We start with the Secretary Briones because I think it's the foremost in the minds of people. Go ahead, ma'am. Let the cameras be trained to...
Thank you, Mr. President. My statement will be very short. It's based on a letter which I wrote to you after you made your statement about not allowing the opening of classes during the time of COVID. And so we are here from the DepEd to assure you that we are one with you in your uncompromising stand on the matter of the health and the safety of our learners and our teachers. You said, I will not allow the opening of classes na dikit-dikit ang mga bata. Para sa akin, bakuna muna bago andyan ang bakuna, okay na. We are saying because there is confusion and anxiety among Filipinos, families, especially the parents. We are here to state that we are one with you, Mr. President, in this non-negotiable commitment. It is the first and the most important principle when we worked out our learning community plan with all the details. We stated this also. The first and foremost concern is the health and safety of our learners and our teachers. Mr. President, there has been a confusion among our people who associate the opening of school with what we describe as face-to-face classes, where we are used to learners, we are used to teachers facing each other, and we are used to children going to school physically. But we are saying that there will be no face-to-face classes and sessions until we are assured of the safety of our children and our teachers. However, we also believe, Mr. President, that we can provide learning opportunities to our students without necessarily requiring them to go to school. And this we can do through what is described as blended and distant learning. Mr. President, this is not a new thing. We have many universities and schools which offer distant learning in many ways. We now call it blended learning because various approaches which are adjusted to the actual situation of the communities will be applied. But these are all, Mr. President, consistent with your preference that we should not be physically sending our children to school until it is safe to do so. What is the so-called blending or learning modalities? Because right now, there is a bill which is filed in Congress on this. One, for those who don't have connections, who don't have interactive facilities, there will be what we describe as printed material which will be delivered to the homes of the students through the barangays, can be picked up also by their parents at designated places within coordinated schedules. We'll be working very closely with the barangays and the local governments. And the second approach is now very popular, Mr. President. This is the online learning platform, and we in DepEd, we have what we describe as DepEd Commons. Right now, we already have over 7 million subscribers, wherein lessons, homework, quizzes, tips to learners and to teachers are all in the DepEd Commons and are accessible even to the parents. So we have instances, Mr. President, of parents who are abroad and who are monitoring what is happening to their children. They also go to the DepEd Commons and check on how their children are doing. Now, in cases, Mr. President, where there is no connectivity and printed materials may not be available immediately, we have the classic long-time approaches, which have always been used in education, and this would be television. Those homes which do not necessarily have connectivity and may have television. And the most and the best used approach, of course, is radio-based instruction. Kasi ang television, mga 1950s, 60s, radios have been around since the 1800s when it was first invented. And we know that two world wars were won through radio messages and not necessarily computers and so on. So yung printed modules, Mr. President, we have a description of what it entails. And then also, on the matter of online, ito yung popular talaga, it's gaining popularity, online distance learning with already 7 million subscribers. And we assume here that they have access to internet. And one worry is, how about the students and the teachers? Do they have access to laptops? We made a survey, Mr. President, of teachers, more than about 788,000 of them, to find out whether they have laptops or desktops in their homes. More than 80%, nearly 700,000, have laptops or desktops in their homes, because teachers acquire these for various uses. They have family members abroad or friends, etc., etc. So this is a very, very popular mechanism for dispensing education. Now, for those who don't have access to interconnectivity, then we have television. Right now, Mr. President, 15% of television time, this is provided by law, should be dedicated to programs of programs designed for children. So there are already existing educational programs on television stations. What we need to do is to utilize these programs to transmit our curricula. And we are working out how to do this. For example, Mr. President, PCOO is volunteering its TV facilities and also IBC13, which is radio, for the utilization of lessons through radio and television. Radio and television for those who don't have access to a computer. Now, radio-based instruction is quite popular, Mr. President, because right now, municipalities are volunteering. Usually, municipalities have their radio stations. Cities have radio stations. There are local radio stations, and big networks also have radio stations. And many of them have lessons, which yung tawag nyon is schools of the air. Mayroong mga religious groups, they give lessons in agriculture, lessons in whatever sciences over the air, because alam nila not everybody has access to television or to online computers. So ito yung pinaka ancient, pinaka matandang paraan for teaching as an alternative to face-to-face. Now, Mr. President, what we are doing in the regions is, the regions are different from each other. Some regions have many islands, some regions have many mountains, some regions have interconnectivity, and so on and so forth. So what our regions are now doing is to translate our curriculum from curriculum for lecturer, the teacher lectures the children for long periods of time. It has to be translated, one, into digital modes sa platforms natin, into television programs, because children have to be taught through in a different way. Iba yung effect ng television programs because their attention span can be very brief as well. And then also converted into radio scripts. So this is where much of the work is now being concentrated. What we are saying, Mr. President, is that we fully and completely support your stand that our children should not be exposed to the dangers of COVID-19 physically, but we are also offering opportunities for them to continue their studies and their learnings. And some people ask, are we prepared? What we are trying to do, Mr. President, are not really new. Hindi naman to bagong invento. Because distance education, many universities have distance education programs. Many local governments have radio stations. We are utilizing existing ways of communication without necessarily requiring our children to go to school. So they can still go to school, they can still study, teachers can monitor them as well as their parents. So ito yung ano namin, Mr. President, which we would like to share with you, and we seek your approval of our alternative ways of learning, which are already existing right now. And these are being done by many schools, but this time, mas malaki ang emphasis because we are now shifting to less physical, face-to-face classes. But education will continue, Mr. President. Thank you.
I'm impressed with the simplicity of the program. And I believe that all that you have said is really feasible. Radio, walang television, and all of these things. I believe we have a very workable program, and I support you.
Thank you.
And should you require any help from any of the departments, feel free to communicate with them. If it's a question of funding, I will sort to speak, scrape the bottom of the barrel. just to, well, kung wala na tayong pera, edukaran lang sa edukasyon sa mga bata. We'll have to forgo many things along the way because of what happened. But education, I think, if it is compromised, it should be negligible, so that it should go on, because the future of this country depends on the how we educate our young people nowadays. I agree with you in this program. I support you. And if there's anything that we can do, the ILG and or whatever,
we will thank you very much, Mr. President.
Endeavor to help you.
Thank you.
So, with that, we're through with education. I would just like to announce to the public, as of today, we have a total number of COVID cases of 15,588. Now, the recoveries, 92 new ones, with a total of something like 3,598 to date. Ang patay po is 921. So you would see that Philippines has ratio and proportion vis-a-vis with the population. We have a low rate of mortality here in this country. The total active cases is 11,069. So, in CR, is top notcher, which is 330 or 61%. Then we have region 7, 55, others 99, repatriate. Yung dati na, dala dito 55. All in all, para sa akin, hindi naman masama ito. So let's go to the Secretary of, he has some important matters to take up with the public. Secretary Duque, please.
Magandang gabi po, Mr. President and fellow members of the Cabinet at sa lahat po ng ating mga kababayan. Gaya po ng sinabi ni Pangulo, ang ating pong kaso na nadagdag as of 4 o'clock p.m. Today, May 28, 539 at 330 nag-galing po sa NCR, 55 naman galing sa Central Visayas at 99 mula sa ibang mga rehiyon at 55 na mga repatriates na ito po yung kasama sa mga lumalaking bilang ng ating po mga OFWs na isinasa ilalim po natin sa RT-PCR testing. At karamihan po sa ating mga kaso ay masasabi natin pong mga local. Ang total number of cases po natin ngayon ay 15,588 at kumpara po sa nakaraan araw ay ang trend ng bilang ng mga kaso ay tumaas. Ngunit dahil po ito sa patuloy din na pagtaas ng bilang ng mga kasong atin pong nava-validate. Ngayon, ibig ko rin pong bigyan diin na ang DOH po, ang ating missions na mga iba't ibang mga laboratories. Pero yung mga ibang mga laboratories ay late pa rin sa pagsumiti nila ng kanilang Excel sheets. Yung iba naman po ay patuloy ang manual validation process. At yung mga ibang ibig kong bigyan na pansin ang mga laboratorio na nag-automate na po ng kanilang mga sistema. So mabilis po ang pag-sumiti ng kanila pong mga laboratory results. Tumaas man po ang atin kaso, pero sa pangkalahatan naman, ang mild cases po natin ay asa 90%. At 7.3% naman ang asymptomatic, yung wala pong nararamdaman na sakit. At less than 2% naman po ang severe to critical cases. At ibig ko rin pong bigyan din na sa kasalukuyan po ang ating health systems capacity ay sapat. In fact, we have around mga 60+% reserve capacity in terms of available mechanical ventilators, available intensive care units, and also our isolation beds. Ano po? So, meron pong tayong 92 na bilang ng ating mga kababayan na nadagdag sa mga naka-recover. Kaya sa kabuuan, ito po ay umabot na ng almost mga 3,600 recoveries. Kasama po sa mga naka-recover ay ang mga pasyenteng na-confine at mga pasyenteng may mga positive mild and symptomatic cases na na-recover mula sa kanilang self-isolation at home quarantine. Ngunit malungkot po kami na meron po tayong mga 17 na mga kababayan na dagdag sa bilang ng atin na mga pumanaw dahil po sa sakit na COVID-19. At kami po ay nakikiramay sa mga pamilya na naulila bunsod po ng pagpanaw ng atin pong 17 mga kababayan. Yun lang po, Mr. President, ang akin na update po. Maraming salamat, sir.
Thank you, Secretary Duque, for that report. I hope that the public is able to grasp the whole of the dimensions na binigay ni Secretary Duque for your information. Now I'd like to call on Secretary Tugade if he has something to say about the airports and other, not only the airports, but other means of transportation under your department.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, magandang gabi po. Let me predicate what I'm going to say and present by saying that while the mandate of the Department of Transportation and Kagawaran and Transportation is to provide transportation, mobility, and convenience amongst its population, it is now also vested with the responsibility that the Department of Transportation must help in preventing the spread of the coronavirus. This having been said, the approach of the Department of Transportation is partial, gradual and calculated, and more importantly, by phases. Kaya nga ba't kung ang tatanungin, ano yung gagawin ng Department of Transportation in transitioning from MECQ to GCQ? Allow me to state in addressing immediately the query of the mayor in saying, ano ang mangyayari sa mga paliparan sa mga airport? Ganito po yung polisiya na gusto naming mangyari sa paliparan at airport. Una po, ngayon ho concentrated yung international landing and takeoff doon po sa NAIA 1, Terminal 1, 2, 3, and 4. Ang gagawin po namin once we transition from MECQ to GCQ is to expand the international aviation gateways to include Clark, Cebu, and Davao. Mahalagang sasabihin namin na as we expand the international gateways, aviation gateways, kaakibat ho nito yung plano namin magtayo ng mga test laboratories. Meron na hong matatapos na laboratory testing sa Clark, meron na hong matatapos sa Cebu. Ito po, pag nagawa ito, mahalaga ho ito. Kasi kung darating ho yung mga pasahero from international sa mga primary gateways na ito, kailangan ho yung testing facilities na doon. Kaya nagkakapit-bisig ho kami sa Department of Health saka sa Red Cross na kung saan mapadali yung accreditation ng mga laboratories na ito. Mahalaga ho na sabihin na while we put up the testing laboratories, there are already accredited hospitals which can do the testing in Clark and in Cebu. Kaya nga ho, kung wala pa yung accreditation ng Red Cross or ng DOH, pwede na hong gamitin yung mga paliparan na to. Hangarin po namin na kung sa pag-umpisa ng transition from MCQ to GCQ, hangarin po namin na every 1 or 2 weeks, dagdagan yung international gateways para mapasama yung Zamboanga, Iloilo, Bacolod, and Bohol. Mahalaga ho ito kasi this is one way of decongesting what is happening right now at NAIA Terminal 1, 2, 3, and 4 and putting it in the provinces and region. Bear in mind that we are an archipelago and therefore it is imperative that we spread the aviation centrum of operations to other parts of the country, other parts of the region. Kaya nga ho gagamitin ito. Ngayon, ito po yung international. Kaakibat ho nung international ay yung domestic operation. Iaalaw po namin na magkaroon ng domestic air operation dun po sa GCQ to GCQ. Mahalaga ho ito pagkat gaya ng sinabi ko, tayo ho ay isang archipelago. Kaya nga ba kung magkakaroon tayo ng operasyon sa Mindanao at Bisaya, hindi ho natin ililimit na magmula at magsimula sa Central Luzon yan. Meron na hong Visayas and Mindanao. And we will start what I call, Mr. President, Mayor, Sir, yung tinatawag namin na hub and spoke operation. HUBSPOKE. Na kung saan, kung darating yung mga malalaking sasakyan sa mga probinsya, magkakaroon ho ng domestic operation yan. In other words, gusto ho natin na magkaroon na ng hubbing operation sa mga probinsya at region natin nang sa ganon, ma-spread yung aviation potentials at maitanim yung punla para sa tinatawag natin not only of domestic mobility but more importantly and so yung domestic tourism. Ito po, Mayor, ang general approach sa aviation. Kung papayagan po ako ng ating mahal na alkalde, presidente, magsabi lang ho ako ng ibang mga pamaraan at panuntunan na gagawin sa ibang transportation sector, kagaya ng tren, nung road, at nung maritime, kung papayagan po ng ating Pangulo. Sasabihin ko ho, kung tayo magta-transition from MECQ to GCQ, on the first day that we transition and it's put into effect, we can already put into operation our train and rails operation. Habang nag-uusap po tayo ngayon, nagsisimula ang ating mga tao sa rails at railways na kung saan sinisimulate nila kung paano maumpisa to. Sabihin ko na lang ho, namarkahan na yung bawat upuan, namarkahan na yung bawat ali, namarkahan na yung pagbili ng ticket, namarkahan na yung queuing. Anda na ho ito. Pag sinabing Lunes, anda ho kami sa Lunes. Bagamat sasabihin ko antemano, huwag i-expect na yung operational ng train is 100%. As I said, we have to balance our mandate to provide transportation with our responsibility to help in the spread of the virus. Therefore, the capacity will also be limited, gradual, and calculated. It will be an average of 10 to 12% sa LRT at MRT. Doon sa PNRO, ang capacity, mga 35%. Ngayon ho, para maayos ito, sabihin ko na lang ho, part of the future efforts here, ito po ang sasabihin ko. Matatapos na ho namin yung pagpalit ng release ng tren sa MRT3 by September of this year. Ano ho ang ibig sabihin nito? Ang ibig kong sabihin nito, na pag umandar na yung MRT3 sa kabuuan ng kanyang pagdagusdos at maayos na yung trend, yung average headway ho natin na 5 minutes mababawasan ho yan. Yung kilometers per hour travel time na ngayon 30 kilometers per hour, by December ho, Mr. President, target po namin na yung speed magiging 60 kilometers per hour kasi nabago na yung release ng trend. Mababalik po ito sa dati na kung saan sabi natin, eto na yung MRT3. Bakit importante yung rails? Importante yung rails sa katren pagkat, kasi ho, Mr. President, massive ho ang pasahero nito kumpara sa modernized jeepney, sa grab, sa taxi, mas madami ho dito. Kaya concentrated ho kami dyan. Ngayon, to augment, because limited capacity yung takbo ng tren, meron ho kaming tinatawag na bus augmentation system. Yung bus augmentation system, ganito po yon in generic terms. Ikakasa ho namin yung operation ng tren with a bus operation following the same line. Para nang sa ganun, ma-achieve natin more or less yung tinatawag na volume of passengers that move. Ngayon ho, mag-i-introduce ho kami ng bagong pamaraan. Ito hong bus augmentation system ay magkakaroon ng tinatawag na dedicated lane sa EDSA, mid lane. Ibig sabihin, may tatakbo ho dyan na bus. Sa umpisa ho, kasi sinabi po natin, gradual, calculated, and partial. Ito ho, baka gamitin ho muna namin dyan, Mr. President, mga 300 to 500 buses. Sasamahan ho yan. Pag nagawa ho ito, i-increase po namin yan. Maalala niyo ho yung LRT na nasira ng tatlong istasyon na hindi pa mag-ooperate ngayon? Lalagyan ho namin ng bus operation yon para yung 10 stations ng LRT will be put in operation with the combination of rail and bus. Meron hong bus augmentation system, babaguhin ho namin ng EDSA. Sasabihin ko na rin ho yung gagawin nating landscape sa EDSA. Ultimately, magkakaroon po tayo ng tinatawag na bike lane na kung saan nakikipagkapit-bisig kami sa MMDA at the Department of Public Works para maumpisahan at buhayin ulit yung tinatawag na bicycle lane. Pag ito ho na na-prove sa aming eksperimento na kaya, gagawin ho namin yung estrukturang permanent. Sabihin ko lang ho na yung bicycle lane will not be limited to EDSA. It will be limited to parts of the country if it works. Ngayon ho, ang component ho ng road sector, kung o-operated mo yung road sector, ano naman ang mag-o-operate sa kalsada? Nasabi ko na ho, yung bus augmentation system. Ma-o-operate ho yung P2P, point to point. Wala hong stop yan. Ibig sabihin, itong P2P, sasama sa dedicated lane, sa agos ng dedicated lane. Nandiyan dyan po, yung tinatawag natin na yung Grab sa taxi, pwede hong mag-operate dyan. Sabihin ko na lang ho, Mr. President, alam niyo ho ba na uumpisahan natin part of the new normal? Magkakaroon ho tayo ng digitalized operation sa taxi, sa bus, na kung saan merong cashless transaction, again, to help prevent the spread of the disease. Ito na ho yung mga card system. Ginagawa ho at gagawin ho namin sa taxi at saka mga modernized jeepney at sa bus yan. Part of the digitalization program, without oversimplifying, but just to show to our people who are listening and watching, meron ho tayong digitalization program. Alam niyo ho ba, yung lisensya ngayon, pupunta ka sa LTO, doon mo kukunin? Ngayon, minsan yung address nila, problema ho yan, hindi totoo. Nagkakaroon ho kami ng online issuance and application. In addition to that, yung mga lisensya at plaka, yung renewal ng plaka at lisensya, hindi ka na ho pupunta, plano namin, sa LTO offices. I-deliver ho yun ng courier. This is one way also of making sure that the addresses dun sa mga na-issue ng lisensya ay totoo. Kasi ang nangyayari ho ngayon, pag nagkakaroon ho tayo ng problema sa kalsada at hahanapin mo yung address, wala ho dun. So meron ho mga programang ganun. Sasabihin ko na rin ho, part of the digitalization na ginawa na namin even before the COVID is the robotics. Meron na po tayong robot sa LTO. Sila ho yung gumagawa ng plaka. So ito ho, mga gagawin natin. Ngayon ho, kung mararapatin, Mr. President, let me say a little bit about maritime. Dalawa ho yung programa na ginagawa for the first time during the term of President Duterte, Mayor Duterte. Una ho, electronic ticketing system. By December, pwede ko nang umpisahan yan because now it's on a test run. Ano ho ibig sabihin nito? May ticket na ho pag sumakay ka ng mga, kuan natin, mga maritime vessels. Mawawala ho dyan yung scalping. Mawawala rin ho dyan yung overloading kasi ticketed na. Yung ticketing, online ticketing, gagawin din ho yan sa tren. At ginagawa, of course, yan sa aviation, gagawin ho sa maritime. So magkakaroon ho tayo ng online ticketing for the first time. Mabubuo ho natin yan by December. Para sa ating mga kababayan, nandito ho yung sinabi kong palamigan ng bayan. With the problem on COVID at yung sitwasyon at lack ng storage ngayon, yung magsasaka, yung mga mangingisda, nasisira ho yung kanilang tanim at pangisda kasi walang storage. Ang ginagawa po namin, Mr. Mayor, Sir, isinilinsad ho namin yung palamigan ng bayan. Ito ho yung cold reefer na kung saan pinapadala namin ito sa mga komunidad na municipality na merong nangingisda at merong nagtatanim para matulungan yung kanilang pangingisda at ang kanilang pagtatanim, binibigyan ho namin sila. Naka-distribute na ho kami, 11 reefer containers. Plano ko ho, pagdating ng Hunyo, I know it's a tough order to my people, but I'm pushing them. Gusto ko 2 container a month para mapalawig yan. Then we can help di magsasaka and di mangingisda. Sabihin ko na rin ho, Mr. President, sa Maritime, nakatapos na ho kami at rin-report namin sa IATF kahapon ito, na matapos na kami ng puerto at gusto nilang inauguratein pa. Sabi ko, wala nang inaugurate. Operatein mo na lang. Mahigit 10 na o yan. Operatein mo na lang. Wala na tayong inauguration.
I hate ceremonies.
Oh, basta operatein mo na lang. Kasama ho dyan yung pagtatapos ng puerto sa Pagasa. Handa na hong mag-turnover yung provincial government of Palawan na i-turn over sa amin yon sa June 12. Sabi ko, kung maaari, aksipin ko na lang sa papel yan. Huwag na tayo mag-inaugurate. Umpisahan na lang natin. Maraming salamat po, Mayor.
It was a very terrific presentation, Secretary Tugani. We would like to ask Secretary Galvez to make the report first. But, what's the latest on your front, sir?
Sir, you have directed me to visit all the different regions to assure compliance to your directive and see the real situations on the ground. I have already visited Zamboanga City, Davao City, Caraga Region, Bohol, Cebu City Region, the Laguna Region to build the quarantine facility there. Also, I visited Baguio City, sir, to see the good things that Mayor Magalong is doing. I also visited Region 12, and also I visited the malls so that we could see if they are really following the protocols. Sir, they're very thankful to you, sir, and also to Senator Bongo, because we have given them more or less 200,000 rapid test kits. And also, we put up the machine laboratory. When we went to Zamboanga City, sir, we left more or less 1,100 kits. And now they have two laboratories already. And also in Davao, we have already procured, with the help of the different companies, San Miguel Corporation and also Ayala Corporation, they're trying to automate the Southern Philippines Medical Center. And it can increase the capacity of the Southern Philippines Medical Center into more or less 2,000 tests per day. And the machinist will be flown from Zamboanga City to Davao City maybe this coming Saturday, sir, to fix the machines. And then also the Caraga region, they're very thankful because also we provided them 2,500 test kits for every province. And also Bohol, we saw that Bohol will be one of our candidate for the new normal because they're still COVID-free. And considering that most of their businesses came from tourism, we are planning that we will have a preparations for local tourism this coming June and July, and then they may be opening up. If the situations are improved, sir, they will open up tourism again in Bohol. And they're very thankful that we have given them hope that Bohol will be our model for the new normal. And also in Baguio City, sir, we visited Baguio City, and the Baguio City, sir, is very sprawling right now. They have opened up all the business except for mass transportation and also hotel and restaurant. But I talked to Jer Magalong last night, and if the IATF will approve that they will be at MGCQ, they will open up some of its restaurants for dining, and also they will open up local tourism in Baguio City. And then during my visit on the malls, we saw that the people is really very mindful of the pronouncement of the president. As of this moment, what we saw at the malls, we thought that there are many people there, but more or less 10 to 20% of the mall capacity is parang takot pa rin ang tao, sir, na magpunta ng malls. So majority, nakita namin, sir, mga 20 to 30 opening pa lang, sir, ng mga malls. Ang marami lang matao is yung sa mga supermarket. But those who open, nakikita namin, sir, medyo meron pa rin natawag natin precautions. But I believe when I talk to the administrator of the malls, they are very, very happy that the president, the government has given them the hope that there will be an opening. And considering that NCR will be GGCQ'd, they're very happy. Sir, I also visited Cebu City. We met with Secretary Dino, and they are doing good. Though the figures we saw is medyo tumataas po yung kanilang Kalang cases, but we saw that it is in Cebu that they conducted expanded testing. They conducted 32,000 testing, and with the rapid test, and also more or less 16 to 20,000 PCR tests. And they say that they are prepared for the GCQ, considering that when we met all the businessmen there, and they're very happy that we visited them. And they are preparing for the opening of business because they already lost a lot in during the CQ. Mr. President, for all those LGUs and businessmen that we have visited, they are very, very thankful that the government is giving them the support, especially when we go there. We brought PPEs, protective personal equipment for the health workers, and also we provided test kits, including rapid test kits, and also we brought all along with us with the PCR equipment. That's all, Mr. President, and I would like to convey the gratitude of our local government officials and businessmen for the visit.
And also the gratitude of the nation for your untiring services, General Galvez. Dito sa Pilipinas, hindi tayo nagulang ng Benje sa Baguio. He's a very good administrator, being a military man. He has that, I said, the how to craft a government that is really fit for your jurisdiction. Maraming mga leaders na ganon, but mayroon namang iba, and I don't blame them actually. They say that I do not have any quarrel with Richard Gomez, as he was the one who said that he's not going to accept anybody from entering or for that matter leaving the place. Okay mo lang yan, it's a part of maybe the vigilance that a person nurtures in his heart of how to do it. But, you know, there are also constitutional issues that are involved, and those are sacred ones. And for those who are not really pronounced to be infected positive, there's no reason why you should not accept them, especially those who are returning to their homes from doing a work abroad. Kawawa naman kasi. So, yung constitutional right, this is there's no really a reason why you should not accept them with open arms. I think this has been understood by everybody. And unless, well, for one, if you are positive, you can stay with the place where government has to provide for the hospitalization. I want to make it clear that as much as possible, the ordinary citizen, the Filipino, does not have to spend money. If he is sick, he can seek hospitalization and charge everything to government. Wala tayo na. If he happens to be in that place and he cannot move out and maybe is not welcome to the place, he can stay where he finds himself, and this I would like to convey to the mayor. Help anyone, Not even Filipinos, foreigners, who are in your place and who go to you or who goes to the municipal building, the seat of governance of your municipality to seek help. You should expedite the hospitalization. Tulungan ninyo yung mga Pilipino. Total, I will pay for the expenses. Walang problema yan. You just sign a whatever document there, I will pay for the hospitalization of any Filipino who finds himself in a strange place and he has nowhere to go. That is really an order of the national government to the local governments. Help, do not deny, and you must expedite the hospitalization until he is cured. No problem about payment, I will pay. Just bill me, and I will pay. Now, we'd like to hear next speaker. I'd like to ask General Anyo to...
Maraming salamat po, Mr. President. First of all, kung merong isang positive po na nadala ang COVID crisis na to ay sa larangan ng peace and order. Mula po noong panahon bago mag-lockdown, mula January 5 hanggang March 16, 11,004 criminal cases po ang limita or crimes. Pero mula po noong nag-lockdown tayo from March 17 to May 27, bumaba po yung ating crimes ng 4,479, 60% po ang naibaba sa tinatawag nating mga crimes, sa 8 focus crimes. So ito po ay magandang development sa larangan ng peace and order. Pati rin po sa Bureau of Fire Protection, ang ulat nila, kung ikukumpara po yung period mula January hanggang May, sa period po ngayong 2020, from 11,236 fire incidents, bumaba po ng 10,698, 5% po. At sa mga namatay sa sunog, from 283 to 162, 43% down din po ang ating mga casualties mula sa fire. At sa ating mga violators naman po ng quarantine, 184,467 ang nakaroon ng mga violations at 54% po ay naaresto. Ang iba naman dito, katulad ng 9%, ay binigyan lang ng warning at ang 37% naman ay pinagmulta. Tuloy-tuloy rin po ang pagmamatay natin sa lahat ng peace and order. Sa atin po namang repatriation ng OFWs, ang lahat po ng ating LGUs ay tumatanggap na po ng mga OFWs katulad po ng inyong instruction. Kung noona po ay merong alanganin sapagkat hindi sila sigurado kung ito ay pwede pang makapanghawa, so nagkaroon po kami ng kasunduan sa lahat ng LGUs, mayors at governors na lahat po ito ay tatanggapin at pwede na lang sila mag-impose ng additional home quarantine. At kung talagang ang bahay ay masikip, pwede po sa isolation facilities sa mga barangays para abot-tanaw na rin yung ating mga OFWs ng kanilang mga pamilya. So sa inyo pong kautusan ay matatapos po natin hanggang Sabado na maiuwi lahat. Ang natitira na lamang po ay 11,889, pero ang karamihan po rito ay nakabook na yung kanilang mga biyahe hanggang Sabado. At ang naiwan na lang ay 6,468 na kaya po nating matapos ito hanggang weekend. Sa atin pong pagbabago mula MEGCQ papuntang GCQ areas at iba naman pong LGUs ay magiging MGCQ, handang-handa na rin po yung ating mga LGUs sa pagpapatupad kasama yung ating mga kapulisan. Magkakaroon din po kami ng mga pagbabago katulad ng modified checkpoints ang ating patutupad. Meron po tayong mga mobile at spot checkpoints at ito ay nandito sa mga strategic location para hindi magkabuol-buol ang trapiko. At magiging maikwit pa rin tayo sa mga provincial borders. Within the province po ay hindi na kailangan yung ini-issue ng mga barangay quarantine pass. Travel pass na lang po para sa pagdaan niya from one LG, I mean from one province to another o kaya ay from one region to another, ay makikita po natin na may kabuluhan talaga ang nagbibiyahe at hindi siya nagbibiyahe lang para sa leisure lang. Patuloy din po yung pag-inspeksyon natin kasama ang DTI at DOLE sa iba't ibang mga business establishment para masigurado na ipinatutupad yung ating tinatawag na minimum health standards, lalong-lalo na po yung pagsusuot ng face mask, yung physical distancing, at yung pagsunod po na may limit ang kapasidad sa pagtanggap ng mga customer sa loob ng mga shop at mga mall. Sa atin naman pong shop distribution, nakaanda na rin po tayo sa second tranche at iniintay lang po natin ang pagbaba ng mga pondo galing sa DSWD sapagkat ang gagamitin nila ngayon ay automated payment. Base po sa mga SAC form na na-submit noong unang first tranche, mas mabilis po ito sapagkat mga pag-automated payment na iwasan na rin yung pagkukumpul-kumpulan at doon sa lugar na malalayo naman po ay manual pa rin pero katulong na po ang Armed Forces at saka Philippine National Police. Yung 5 milyong additional po ay kinukompleto natin yung mga pangalan. Sa ngayon po ay nasa 3,818,608 names na po yung nakukuha natin at ito yung mga priority na makatanggap sa second tranche. So handa-handa po ang ating LGUs at ang ating mga kapulisan para sa pagpapatupad ng bagong inyong idineklara na mga classification. Bilang tulong din po sa ating DOTR, yung binanggit po ni Secretary Tugade, na gusto natin na ang bicycle po ang maging isang pangunahing pamamaraan ng transportasyon. Kaya nagpababa rin po ako ng memo sa ating mga LGUs na yung lahat ng mga major thoroughfares ay magdugtong-dugtong, magkaroon ng bicycle lanes para ito po ay ating ikampanya na gamitin ng ating mga kababayan bilang pangunahing transportasyon, lalo na kung malalapit lang naman yung mga opisinang pinapasokan at mga lugar na pinupuntahan. Yan lang po, Mr. President. At ready na po kami para sa papatupad ng bagong mga deklarasyon ninyo sa classification ng iba't ibang lugar sa Pilipinas. Thank you po.
Yes, thank you, Jer Anyo. Alam ninyo, if you heard him correctly, I was talking about enforcement and the role of the police. I repeat, there is no martial law in the Philippines. Far from it, we are exercising the power of the state to protect public health. That is all there is to it. Now, because sometimes enforcement can be a very tedious process in explaining to the ordinary citizen, please understand that these are things which we have to do because it is needed to be implemented. Yun lang po, huwag kayong matakot that there will be no arrest, detention or anything. It's purely, if at all, if there's any intervention or interdiction done by the law enforcement agencies. Pati yung military, the role is just to implement the law. They are called upon to assist the civil government. Yan lang ang trabaho na. At makita ninyo, we are progressing at a very fast rate because we were able to put in place the rules to be followed when COVID came in like a storm from the outside. Now, for our last speaker, I'd like to just give the floor to General Lorenzana.
Maraming salamat, Ginoong Presidente. Ito po ay dagdag lang sa mga ulat nila General Galvez at saka General Anyo tungkol ito sa mga ginagawa natin sa mga OFWs. Yung pong utos ninyong magpauwi tayo ng mga 24,000 OFWs na nasa sa Manila ay natupad po. Saka na nalampasan pa po natin yung bilang na yon, ang ating naipauwi ay 26,590. As of last night, mayroon pang mga OFWs niyan, kasama na yung mga bagong dating, na 77,569. Ngayong araw na ito, umalis na, umuwi na yung 3,597. Meron pa natitirang 3,972 na pwede na makaka-uwi linggong ito. Mr. President, yung ating sistema ay naayos na natin. Medyo nagkabuhol-buhol ng una dahil marami tayong mga na salubong na problema. Pero naayos na po natin ito dahil pinag-isa-isa natin, kipag-unayan kami sa DOTR, sa DILG, at saka sa DOLE. Dahil lahat po ng mga ahensya na yan ay may pakialam sa OFWs. Ngayon, mula ngayon hanggang katapusan ng Hunyo, sabi ni Secretary Bello ay may darating na 40,000 na OFWs. Kung po, we can assure you that okay na yan, maayos na natin yan. And we target na ang target po namin ay hindi magtatagal na 4 na araw yung mga OFW rito at makakauwi na sila. Ngayon, kung matutuloy yung balak ni Secretary Tugadi na bubuksan niya yung mga ibang international gateway, ay pwede na nating idiretso yung mga ano doon, mga OFW sa darating at saka seafarers, yung pong nagkatrabaho sa barko, at doon na sila mag-testing. At least malapit na sila sa mga pamilya nila, hindi na sila malulungkot kung sila ay nadadalaw ng pamilya nila kung naka-quarantine man sila. Pero ang kwan po rito, ang balak po rito ay pag dumating po yung OFW, iti-testing sa PCR at mag-quarantine sila ng 3 araw. Paglabas po ng resulta ng test, kung sila ay negative, iuwi na po. Yun lang positive ang maiiwan. Kung ganun pong gagawin natin ay mapapadali po yung trabaho ng lahat at mapapadali rin yung pag-uwi ng mga OFW sa kanilang mga bahay. Yun lang po, Mr. Presidente.
Salamat, General Lorenzana. Alam mo, as you see, if you listen very carefully sa mga pinag-usapan naman dito, it's all geared towards governance. To take care of the citizens' republic. Lahat ho namin ginagawa at huwag ho kayong maniwala. Ako na yung nagsasabi sa inyo. Yung mga test na yung sabi nila yung the unfairly drug the name of Secretary Duque, hindi ho totoo yun. Ang nagbili noon, ang budget, pati yung Office of the President mismo. Sinadya ko yun para madali. Tinanggal ko nga doon kasi overwork na ang Health Department. Ginawa ko yun para mabilis. Itong mga bidder na ito who offered a lower price never participated in the bidding. At ngayon yung matapos na, yun ang nagreklamo, offering a lower price, hoping that you would ignore the bidding and go for their price. Ito yung mga gago na ito, when they were first approached, mahal. Ngayon, may bidding, hindi sila sumali. And suddenly after that, and may I inform the Senator Drilon and Ping Lacson and everybody, ganon ang nangyari. We will have a report coming your way, and that is the stand of the Office of the President. Kami ho ang nag-utos niyan na dito na sa budget para pag-release ng pera, madali, diretso na. It so happened that we have some talagang mga bullshit na tao, at kayo't pa maniniwala ka agad, you better wait for the official report. At least por respeto, little respect coming from the Office of the President, kasi sinadya ko yan. Right at the beginning, you must have heard, sinabi ko, itong pera na ito at binigay ng Congress, wag na wag ninyong gamitin. I said, I even used the word, do not fuck with it. Kasi sabi ko, emergency ito. Itong mga bidding, for as long as we are in a democracy, at sinasabi ko na nga ho sa inyo, tanggalin ninyo yung lowest bid. The lowest bid is the culprit of all corruption, be it national or local. Tanggalin ninyo yan, maghanap kayo ng ibang paraan. Kasi yung bidding na yan, people go around just to make money without really the things that they want to participate in a bid which is non-existent insofar as they are concerned. They are using yung mga cornering of contracts tapos go into a bidding. And we can explain that carefully. Okay. Ito si Senator Drillo, sabi niya, I want where the money went. Well, you will have the explanation. And better believe it because yun ang totoo. Hindi naman kami nabubula. I said, we do not, nabi ko, do not fuck with the people's money. With more reason that we will not fuck with the money that are given. Thank you.